Kennesaw Mountain stands about 15 miles north of Atlanta, an excellent natural barrier with rough terrain, thick woods, sheer cliffs and hills. When Sherman looked out at the area around Kennesaw Mountain, he reported that the whole country was one vast fort, and Johnston must have at least 50 miles of connected trenches. Johnston's men were dug in, and they were also spread out far and wide. Flanking would be difficult, if not impossible. Roads were impassable, and the Confederate General Johnston's position on top of the small mountain gave him control of the railroad going south. Finally, Sherman decided that he would have to attack head on. He later said that both the enemy and his own officers were so used to his flanking maneuvers that no one really believed he would make a straight attack. This move would hopefully wipe away that perception. Sherman's three armies had distinct roles in the battle. General McPherson's Army of the Tennessee, where my own 15th Corps was stationed, would make a feint on the northeastern side of Kennesaw Mountain, but make its real attack on the southwestern portion of Little Kennesaw. That attack would be led by Logan's 15th, which meant a hot and bloody day for yours truly. General Schofield was to move out to his extreme right, demonstrating with his forces in an attempt to pull some of Johnston's army toward him, thinning the rebel lines. General Thomas's Army of the Cumberland would make the main assault in the enemy's center. Thomas was told he could select his own point of attack, so he surveyed the enemy's line. In his estimation, there was not much that looked afford the slightest prospect of success. battle began at 8 a.m. on the 27th. General McPherson's artillery opened up on Kennesaw, and the Rebs fired right back. Kennesaw looked like a volcano. Not that I had time to take in the sights. I was in Brigadier General Lightburn's brigade, part of the 15th, and we were to hit Pigeon Hill, a small bump on the buttocks of Little Kennesaw Mountain. We faced Confederate General Loring's corps, and though we had two more brigades of the 15th with us, we were in difficult straits. There were about 5,500 of us attacking about 5,000 rebels. Given that they were deeply entrenched, and we were climbing, cutting, and crawling through dense brush and steep rocky slopes, we were undermanned for the task. In Lightburn's brigade, we even had to move through a swamp, knee-deep in the sucking mud, under heavy fire, mind you. Our formations fell apart. We were able to overrun the rebels' rifle pits. We were the 15th, after all, but we were stopped there. Thank you. Confederate General Walker's rifles on our south and rebel cannons based on Little Kennesaw, we were being cut to pieces and had to fall back. The other brigades had similar trouble, eventually hiding behind trees and rocks and taking shots at the Confederate works, which seemed all but invulnerable. Finally, General Logan himself rode up to survey the scene, saw his men were being butchered for no benefit, and ordered them to withdraw and retrench. Thomas, charged with carrying the main attack, had to delay an hour to give his infantry time to arrange. His cannons opened up at 8 a.m. sharp, but it was another hour before his infantry could move forward. Fortunately for us, the Confederate units holding the center were the two least likely to fold under pressure. Generals Patrick Claiborne and Benjamin Cheatham were blooded veteran commanders who had seen tough fighting in prior battles and emerged victorious. They were well entrenched and supported by cannons. The only weak point was a hill where limited forest resulted in significantly weaker abatis. Further, the lay of the land was such that for a portion of their charge, the Union brigades were blocked from sight. But they had to go through a hailstorm of bullets to get to that point. They call that hill Cheatham's Hill now, which should tell you how it turned out. They don't name hills after losing. Colonels McCook and Mitchell attacked the hill, but were cut down. McCook himself took a fatal wound. His replacement ordered a retreat, but many of their men were either unable to retreat or unwilling to leave cover to flee. 2,000 Union troops surrendered, while others feigned death to escape in the night.
All that you don't have to do is press the pod!
Well, you know, if you're fucking doing it,
That's enough. Sergeant Major, stand down. Stand down.
Just north of them, just around 10 a.m., the hot shells and wadding actually started a fire in the woods, and wounded Union soldiers were trapped, facing a fiery death. Then, Confederate Lieutenant Colonel Will Martin made a makeshift white flag of truce and waved it, shouting to Union troops to come and get your wounded. They are burning to death. We won't fire till you get them away. And both sides ceased fighting long enough for soldiers to rescue wounded Union troops. Once done, fighting resumed. I hope I'm making it clear that we were in a bad place. The only success of the day was General Schofield's. And while carrying out his orders to demonstrate on his extreme right, he found a place where our army could move around the Confederates. Late that night, Sherman finally agreed that this was the best strategy. Once again, we flanked Johnston's army, and once again, he felt forced to withdraw to a new line of defense. It was a bitter withdrawal, no doubt, as they had hit us harder than at any other time in the Atlanta campaign. But we were moving past him now, toward Atlanta. Things were by no means easy after that, though it would never be that bad again. Johnston continued to fall back as we continued to move forward, and we gathered willing rebel prisoners, deserters, by the hundreds.